Photosynthesis uses light energy, water, and carbon dioxide in two processes to ultimately produce energy molecules like glucose or building molecules like cellulose. Oxygen is a byproduct of the light-dependent reaction, and the ATP and NADPH that are made in the light-dependent reaction fuel the light-independent reaction, or Calvin cycle. Let's take a deeper dive into exactly how these processes really work, starting with the light-dependent reactions which occur on the thylakoid discs. The membrane of the thylakoid discs have proteins embedded in them which carry out the light reaction. Outside the thylakoid disc is the stroma, and inside is the thylakoid space. Light strikes photosystems, which are clusters of chlorophyll and other light-harvesting pigments. When light excites electrons in the chlorophyll of the photosystem, the chlorophyll is photoactivated. There are two photosystems in the membrane, but they were discovered out of order. Photosystem 2 is actually the first to be activated in the light reaction. Two photons of light have excited two chlorophyll electrons in photosystem 2, but they need to be captured in order to do work. Plastoquinone will accept the two electrons becoming reduced in the process. The chlorophyll in the reaction center of PS2 is a strong oxidizing agent and will split a water molecule to replace the missing electrons, leaving two protons and an oxygen ion in its wake. This process is called photolysis. Photolysis occurs rapidly and constantly in the presence of light, so another water molecule will be split and the two oxygen atoms will form molecular oxygen, which can then diffuse out of the plant. It's a byproduct or waste product of photosynthesis, since it's not used here. Let's go back to our electrons in plastoquinone. Plastoquinone carries electrons from PS2 to the electron transport chain located in the thylakoid membrane. As electrons are transferred in the electron transport chain, energy is released and hydrogen ions are pumped across the thylakoid membrane into the thylakoid space. The concentration of protons in the thylakoid space is therefore increased by photolysis and the electron transport chain. The protons can exit the thylakoid space through ATP synthase. As they move through ATP synthase, ADP is phosphorylated to make ATP, which can be used in the light-independent reactions. This step in photosynthesis is very similar to the chemiosmosis process in cellular respiration. Our electrons, however, are still not done with their journey. At the end of the electron transport chain is photosystem 1. Light strikes photosystem 1 and excites electrons, which are passed to ferredoxin. The electrons are replaced by ones carried from the electron transport chain. Two molecules of ferredoxin are used with NADP reductase to reduce NADP to NADPH. This is the final electron acceptor. This molecule will be used in the light-independent reactions. If NADP runs out, cyclic photophosphorylation will occur. This involves the electron transport chain and photosystem 1. The electrons move from ferredoxin back to plastoquinone through the electron transport chain, which brings in hydrogen ions. These ions will diffuse through ATP synthase, and the electrons continue the cycle through photosystem 1 again. This keeps the production of ATP high, since more ATP will be needed than NADPH in the Calvin cycle. Now, the ATP and NADPH produced from the light reactions can be used to power the light-independent reactions of the Calvin cycle. The Calvin cycle occurs in the stroma, which fills the spaces of the chloroplast. This is where the molecule building actually occurs. The Calvin cycle is also known as the light-independent reaction, because light is not directly used in this process. The purpose here is to produce carbon-based molecules that can be used for energy, storage, and structural purposes. The carbon source for all photosynthetic organisms is carbon dioxide. The first step of the cycle is called carbon fixation because carbon dioxide is converted, or fixed, into an organic compound. The carbon dioxide reacts with ribulose bisphosphate, a 5-carbon compound, and water. The enzyme that catalyzes this carboxylation is called ribulose bisphosphate carboxylase, or RuBisCO for short. This produces two molecules of glycerate 3-phosphate. These two molecules are then reduced by 2-NADPH and 2-ATP to make two molecules of triose phosphate. Triose phosphate is really the goal product of the Calvin cycle. In reality, however, the Calvin cycle will use three carbon dioxide molecules at a time to ultimately produce six triose phosphate molecules. But while the effort, the triose phosphate molecule is a simple carbohydrate that can be used by the plant to build larger molecules. However, it's also needed to remake the ribulose bisphosphate that was used in the beginning of the Calvin cycle. So of the six made, one triose phosphate will be used by the cell for whatever it needs, and the other five triose phosphate molecules will be recycled back into three molecules of RuBP. This means three turns of the Calvin cycle make one triose phosphate to be used by the cell, and three RuBP are recycled. It uses 6-NADPH and 9-ATP to form the triose phosphate and reform the RuBP. To make a hexose sugar like glucose, six turns of the Calvin cycle will be needed to make the six-carbon sugar. So after six turns, one hexose molecule can be made, which uses six carbon dioxide molecules, 12-NADPH, 18-ATP, 6-RuBP, and regenerates the 6-RuBP as well. The spent ADP and NADP molecules can be recharged in the thylakoid discs by the light reaction. Thanks for watching this episode of Teacher's Pet. Don't forget to like and subscribe and follow me on Twitter @SciencePet.